Let's go ahead and get going. Okay, so we left off looking at the fact that when God is walking us through this process of change, that he's always, it's never just change for change's sake. He's changing us to a standard. And that standard is none other than Jesus himself. And it's the character of Jesus that is revealed in God's commands and promises. And so we find through those commands and promises that describes that Jesus always obeys, how he trusts, and how God's commands and promises really work hand in hand with each other. So the question is, that's the standard that he's comparing us to, but how does he get us to see what we're really like? That he has to show that we are not anywhere near to where that standard is. And so he has to kind of unearth that. And so we're willing to admit that we're not perfect. You know, most people are willing to admit that, but we're not willing to admit it to the degree that we need to the degree that we're going to just say, you know what, I can't do this on my own. I can't change as much as I need to. We see ourselves just saying, well, need some improvement and I'll get there. But God knows that it's far, far greater than that. And so this brings us to the next thing, which is triggers. He has to compare us to the standard. And so since we are masters of disguise, you know, we are people who go through life wearing a mask of self-righteousness. That's pretty much how we live every day. We pretend to be better and stronger than we really are. And so God has to kind of get our mask off. He has to catch us off guard being ourselves, being who we really are, not the person that we're pretending to be. And so what does he do? He surrounds us with relationships and circumstances that are designed to trigger an unguarded response, right? If you know that you're getting ready to be tested on a certain behavior or a certain attitude, and you know, okay, at 110, someone's going to say something or something's going to happen and it's going to test your patience, all right? Well, if you know that ahead of time, you're going to be ready for it. And so you're going to be really patient at 110, okay? Well, the problem is that's not the way you really are. You really have the root issue that's causing anger, the root issue that's causing impatience, whatever. And so God's just patient with that. He just surrounds us with these triggers that ultimately catch me off guard. And so I don't know when they're going to come up, and that flash, that immediate response catches me being who I really am. And that's really important, okay? And so let's look at an example of that. This is the same couple. This is them together, and you're just going to watch them triggering each other, okay? So listen to how they, what it looks like. There's nothing rocket science-y about this.
Save up my boat for you. You're not taking that from me.
So,
Yeah, shut the door on your way out.
Okay, so did you catch at the beginning? You know, very controlled, very civil. Not necessarily very loving, but at least very, very civil. But all it takes is just one stray comment, and boom, things just start to unravel very quickly. When he says, did I offend you by walking in the door? Well, as a matter of fact, yes, you did. You just your presence offends me. But that's what triggers look like. That's how they function. So let's explore them just a little bit. So like we said, triggers are any relationship or any circumstance that you experience in life. And once again, they catch us off guard being ourselves. And so we don't have time to go into circumstances really at this point, but once again, these are designed to find out, will I obey, will I trust? Okay, that's what they're trying to get at. And so if we just look at relationships, for example, I think that there's two types of relationships in very broad sense. On the one side are what we call assigned relationships. And so these are the closest people that you have in your life that you really don't, once you're in this relationship, you really don't have the option to step out of it, at least from God's point of view legally. I mean, you can, but it's not intended that you would do this. And so, you know, you don't get to pick your parents. They are who they are. You don't get to pick your children. They are who they are. You mean, you decide whether you have children or not, but once they're born, that's it. You know, they're there. And the same thing with the siblings. You don't get to pick them. But the only one that you get to pick is your spouse. But once you marry the spouse, from God's point of view, that's it. You're there, okay? And these people are your triggers. And so, once again, the idea is that a trigger is not a bad thing. A trigger is a good thing. God uses triggers to get behind my mask. And so who is better able to get at you than these people? Right? So your spouse gets under your skin quicker than anybody else. They know exactly where to rub. Okay, just to kind of get you, lose your temper or whatever. And the same thing with children. And so you just have to ask yourself, who are my main triggers? You don't have to wonder who they are. These people, if you have them, they are your assigned triggers. Now, what's good about this is to understand that, well, you know, when different relationships break up, it's usually because people say, well, we didn't get along. Well, duh, of course you didn't get along. Nobody gets along, okay? They're triggers. They're supposed to be different. They're supposed to be not getting along. This is why it's revealing this, okay? And so when I understand that this is how God is using that person in my life, rather than them being an annoyance to me, now I realize, you know what? Thank you, trigger. God's using you to shape my life. God's using you to make me like Jesus. And so everything that trigger is revealing is revealing what has to be shown in order to be able to grow. You can't repent of a sin that you don't know about. And so if you're struggling with anger and your trigger is revealing anger in you, that's an important thing. We'll come back to that in just a minute. On the other side are universal relationships, and these are just a sampling of them. Authority figures, friends, coworkers, random people that you meet on the street. You're around these people all the time, but these people come and go, okay? You might encounter them one time in your entire life, or on some days, but not on other days, whatever. But these are not assigned in the same sense that the other group is. Probably the most important one are the authority figures in your life. There's nothing that reveals a heart like an authority figure. Okay, that could be a parent or whatever, but teachers, bosses, all them. How I respond to them says so much about the difference between me and Jesus. This is where it's going to bring out my true heart. So another point here about how triggers work. Triggers are designed to reveal whether we are trusting and obeying. I tend to think that if you would survey people on how good they are at trusting and obeying, we would probably rate ourselves more higher on the scale than other people would rate us, than even God would rate us, okay? So his job is to show us, you know, we're not doing so hot here, really. Thirdly, like I said, you don't get to pick your trigger. Triggers happen. So circumstances happen to you. You don't generally get to pick your circumstances. And the same, so the same thing is true with people. And another important point, triggers don't cause you to sin, they reveal sin. This is a very important point. They don't cause you to sin, but this is what we're doing, right? We're blaming, we're justifying. The reason why I did this is because my parents, this is the way they treat me. Or my kids, this is, they're always doing this, and this is why I act this way. And we just go down the list. No, they're not making you sin. No one can make you sin. All they can do is reveal the sin that's already there. You're choosing to respond to them in whatever way that you are. And so you can't blame it on anyone else. Now, that's not the way our society looks at it, but that's the way that God looks at it. And so fifthly, if we eliminate our triggers, you lose the ability to grow. And we are masters of doing this. We find people, we find circumstances that are triggering things in us that we don't like, and what do? We avoid them. Well, if you understand how God uses triggers, that I need triggers in order to see the real me, you embrace them. You seize them for the value that they offer in your life, and it changes your attitude towards your trigger. Okay? There's a lot more that we could say here, but I think this is enough. So the question is, who's your trigger? Who's your main trigger in life? And what are they triggering in you? That takes us to our next point. Once you have this trigger, watch the response. And so if you're at camp, for example, and you're watching your campers, you know, one of the main triggers that they're going to be encountering at camp are friends and authority figures. So if you're a dorm leader, you're an authority figure. If you're a teacher in their classroom, you're an authority figure. And so you're watching to see how they handle things that you tell them. So let's say you say, okay, guys, it's time to settle down and we're going to pay attention to how, because class is getting ready to start. And so if you see them not responding, what are you finding out about them? You're finding out that they have an authority problem. Well, that's not hard to see, okay? You're not causing their authority problem. You're revealing their authority problem, all right? And so you just kind of log that away. If you start seeing this over a period of time, it's the response that reveals the true them, okay? Now, in this next clip, just before we examine this a little bit more closely, let's just observe an example. And this is very similar to resistance, because in most cases, left to ourselves, our response is always going to be one of resistance. So we looked at the wife, how she responded. Now pay attention to the husband as he is being confronted by a friend who is functioning as a trigger in his life. Okay?
How about her? She wants to read the file that's under her. Well, the drink of peace, okay, Luke? You want the right kind of peace.
What do you mean by that?
You know what the ring on your finger means?
It means I'm married.
Yeah, that one also means you made a lifelong covenant. You put on that ring by saying your vows. The sad part about it is, when most people promise for better or for worse, they really don't mean for the better.
Catherine and I were in love when we got married, but today, we're two very different people. All right, it's just not working out anymore.
Caleb, this song and pepper are completely different. The makeup is different, the taste and the color. But you always seem to get it. And when you...
What'd you do that for? Okay, when people get married, it's for better or for worse, for richer or for poor, in sickness and in health. I know that. But marriage is our fireproof. Sometimes you get burned. Fireproof doesn't mean that the fire will never come. But that when it comes, you'll be able to recover.
You didn't have to blow me.
Don't do it, Caleb. If you put my partner down, you break either one or both of them.
I'm not a perfect person, but better than most. And if my marriage is failing, it is not all my fault.
But Caleb, and I've seen friends who are crying to them and say that you don't even know. But you want to let your own marriage just burn to the ground.
Michael, you are my friend.
Yeah. You are my friend, and I let you say all kinds of stuff to me, but you have stepped over the line, basically, is what he says. I keep forgetting to replace that clip. So maybe one of these days I'll remember that. But do you see how, once again, the transition that takes place, just like we saw with his wife, everything's kind of okay until they start getting too close. And so that's what's going on. It's a trigger. Now, when you're involved in any kind of a parent is intentionally functioning as a trigger to their kids. But I'm watching, rather than just kind of having this be random, I'm teaching you how to obey the rules of the house. What am I doing? I'm watching their response because their response tells me what's going on in their heart. And that's what disciple making is all about. That's all that disciple making is. It's living close enough to people for a long enough period of time that I start seeing patterns in their responses to situations so that I can see where are they struggling. And how do we deal with that? Okay, how is God trying to deal with that in their life? So a couple of things about this. Response reveals the true me. A couple of things. Remember, my response is comparing me to the standard. The trigger is how it flushes out the response, but the response is the key. Whenever you see a trigger, always watch the response. Secondly, it reveals how much I need to change. What's the gap between me and Jesus? And thirdly, the truth about myself is revealed in patterns, like I just mentioned. You know, anybody can be caught off guard and lose their temper or lose their patience or whatever. But what we're looking for, like I said, are patterns of behavior. And so you want to see patterns in your children. You're going to see patterns in other people that you are working with. So whether it's at camp, you won't see patterns unless you have an ongoing relationship with them that puts you into visible range and hearing range. And that's what disciple making is all about. It's not me sitting across the room just watching people at random. It's getting close enough to them so that I know who their triggers are, I can watch for their response, and I watch to see patterns over time. Those patterns will show you where God is trying to work. He's softening them up. And so I use the analogy of a log jam. If you've ever seen a picture of a log jam coming down a river, you'll just see masses and masses of logs all tied up and nothing's going anywhere. And so we think, oh man, in order to do this, I gotta straighten out each log or remove each log from the river in order to get these logs to start flowing again. But that's not how you get a log jam freed up. Because what these loggers know is that log jams are caused by certain strategically placed logs. And so they know where those logs are. They find them, and then they dynamite those logs out, and the rest of it starts to flow through. And I think the same thing is true for us. If I look at my life, I'm going to see all kinds of areas, like we saw with that list of sin families, and you went through, I don't know how many you had, but it's overwhelming to think of how many that I have to work with. Where do I start? Well, I don't have to wonder where I start. What you're going to find as you start paying attention to these principles is that God shows where he's working because those triggers keep popping up. It's not random. It's on purpose. And so God says, This issue is strategic. So let's start with this one first. And what you find sometimes is that your sins tend to be interrelated to one another. And so if you have a sin of impatience and a sin of anger, they tend to flow from the same root cause. And so if I deal with that one issue, I might be only working on my anger, but if I deal with that, all of a sudden, I find improvement in the area of patience, and I wasn't even working on patience. Okay? That's the way it works. It's all tied to the same root. And so God knows this, and that's why he surrounds us with these triggers. And I think I said some of them, they're just always there. But there's others I think are specifically sent by God, as only a sovereign God can do. And so this is what we're watching for. We're watching to see what it is that the triggers reveal. Well, this leads us to this very important moment of discovery. Over time, as you're working with people, watching people, you're going to see that people are locked in this constant battle. This is Romans 7, okay? If you've ever read through Romans 7, this is Paul. Trying to be righteous and failing, trying to keep the law, that's the standard, but he can't do it. And he tries and he fails, and he tries and he fails. And every time he tries, there's a trigger that comes in and boom, it just reveals that he's got this coveting problem that is described in that chapter there. And so over time, as he continues to try and fail, the evidence accumulates to the point where he is overwhelmed and he discovers that he is no match for sin. No amount of self-discipline on his part is going to solve his problem. Okay? And this is really important to be with a person at this moment. So in this next clip, we're going to see the husband coming to this moment, okay? So you're going to see a number of elements in play here, kind of as they're accumulating. Hopefully you're getting quicker at being able to recognize them. You're going to see the standard that's going to be communicated to him. You're going to see a trigger that's being communicated. You're going to see him resisting his response to the trigger, but his response is resistance. But you're going to see him come to a moment of discovery because the evidence has now accumulated to the point that he can't deny the truth anymore. Okay? So watch how this happens. Whoops.
What do you know, Dick?
This is his father.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. I'd say they have what comes to heart for us. Why? Well, it's when you determine whether your heart's in it or not. Makes you check your real motives when things get difficult.
That is wrong with your heart,
huh? No. I thought your mother had a creeping attitude about it.
Yeah, well, Catherine's not buying any of it.
Why do you think that is?
Because she doesn't love me. She doesn't even like me. Then she just about ignored everything I know.
Are you reading everything on these pages?
And Bible verses at the bottom of the, no, I'm not bad. I told you, that is not what I need.
And what do you need?
I need Catherine to wake up to the fact that we're about to get an ugly divorce. And I'm trying to prevent that, and I cannot do it by myself.
And that may be true, but I think you need more than that.
Yeah, if you're going to tell me I need Jesus, please don't. I don't need a crutch to get through life.
I'm sorry, Jesus is much more than a crutch. He's become the most significant part of our lives.
Yeah, why did you say that? He's the most significant part. How is that?
When I realized who I was and who he was, I realized my need for him. I needed his forgiveness and salvation.
See, I don't understand. Why do I need his salvation? What, am I going to be thrown into hell? For what? Because I got divorced?
No, because you violated his standards.
What? Thou shalt not kill? Dad, I help people. I am a good person, according to you.
But God doesn't judge by your standards. He uses his.
And what are his?
Well, truth.
Okay.
Love.
I'm honest.
Faithfulness.
I care about people. I am those things.
Sometimes. But have you loved God, the one who gave you life? His standards are so high, he considers hatred to be murder and lust to be adultery.
Dad, what about all the good I've done?
Son, saving someone from fire does not make you right with God. You've broken his commandments. And one day you'll answer him for that. Caleb, if I were to ask you why you're so frustrated with Catherine, what would you say?
She's stubborn. She makes everything difficult for me. She's ungrateful. She's constantly griping about something.
Has she thanked you for anything you've done in the last 20 days?
No. And you'd think after I wash the car, I change the oil, do the dishes, clean the house, that she would try to show me a little bit of gratitude. Well, she doesn't. In fact, when I come home, she makes me feel like I'm an enemy. I'm not even welcome in my own home, Dad. That is what really ticks me off. Dad, for the last 3 weeks, I have bent over backwards for her. I have tried to demonstrate that I still care about this relationship. I bought a flower, which she threw away. I have taken her insult and her sarcasm, but last night was it. I made dinner for her. I did everything I could to demonstrate that I care about her, to show value for her, and she spat in my face. She does not deserve this, Dad. I'm not doing it anymore. How am I supposed to show love to somebody over and over and over who constantly rejects me?
That's a good question.
Dad, it's not what I'm doing.
Is it?
No. Dad, it's not what this is about.
So you just asked me, how can someone show love over and over again when they're constantly rejected? Caleb, the answer is, you can't love her because you can't give her what you don't have. I couldn't truly love your mother if I understood what love really was. It's not because I get some reward out of it. I've now made a decision to love your mother whether she deserves it or not. Son, God loves you even though you don't deserve it. Even though you've rejected him. Spat in his face. God sent Jesus to die on the cross and take the punishment for your sin because he loves you. The cross was offensive to me until I came to it. But what I did, Jesus Christ changed my life. That's when I truly began to love you, Mom. So, I can't send this to you. This is between you and the Lord. But I love you too much not to tell you the truth. Can't you see that you need him? Can't you see that you need his forgiveness? Trust him with your life.
So you see how all the pieces come together in that. You know, you can see his patterns of resistance, all the justification and the blaming and the avoidance with his dad. You see all of that stuff. And what amazes me, and I realize that this is scripted, right? It's a movie. But what I enjoy watching still is the fact that in this relationship, you know, this is a father who knows his son. And so he's asking him questions. He's not lecturing him. This is such a hard thing, I know, in my life to learn. But he's asking questions. And you know what's amazing to me is that have you ever gotten into a situation where you're trying to work with somebody to try to help them see something, and you can't think of what to say? You can't think of what to ask? nothing. It's just your mind goes blank. That's the way it works for me. And I can't think of what to say. Once you understand that there is a pattern to the way that God works in a life, that there is a process that he uses, I'm not going to say that that solves the problem, but I can tell you this much, and I have proven this out. Once you know that God uses a standard, and there's triggers, and there's responses, all of a sudden now, I know what to ask about. And sometimes at first, I'm just kind of asking questions, would seem at random, because I don't really know where to go with it. But all of a sudden, what I find is that as you're asking questions and you're watching and listening to their response, it's like the Spirit of God says, that's something right there. And then you respond, you ask another question about it. I'm not a counselor. I have no training in counseling, okay? But when you hear these things, all of a sudden, and half the time when I'm talking to people, I am crying out to God saying, Lord, I have no idea how to help this person. I have no idea what their problem is. And you're gonna have to help me see. You're going to have to help me hear, because I don't know what I'm looking for. But I know in general what I'm looking for. I'm asking questions that are going to help show me what their triggers are. And then I'm going to be asking them, how do you respond to your triggers? Even if I'm not there to actually see them, I ask them. And you start asking enough questions, and you start seeing that there's a common pattern to their triggers, and there's a common pattern to their responses. And the more you ask, the picture starts to get clearer and clearer. Sometimes it can take weeks for that to happen. So that's not counseling. They're not sitting on a couch, leaning back, kind of revealing all their inner thoughts. No, it's just two people. This was a father and a son doing what? They're just being a father and a son. It's just you being a friend. That's all that counseling is. It's just knowing how to apply what God is doing and how to look for what God is doing in a life and knowing how to ask those questions. But there comes a point in that whole process where a person, God has gathered enough evidence from enough different sources, sources that you may not know anything about, people who have said stuff to them, things they've heard on the radio, things they've read, and you don't know anything about those things, but those things are just kind of simmering in their mind. And all of a sudden, you happen to be that person who's there at that moment. It may not be you, it might be somebody else, but let's say it's you at that moment, and you happen to ask the last question that needs to be asked. And all of a sudden, they're ready to admit, you're right. I need a savior. You're right. I do have an anger problem, and I don't know what to do about it. And the dam bursts, and they just pour out their heart, and then you're saying, God, oh man, I'm not sure what to do with this person right now. You know, they're just blubbering all over the place. But that's how it works. I've watched this happen, and I watch it in amazement. Not because I know how to handle it. I just watch it because I see that this is how God is working. And if you take this and you apply this to all the different stories in Scripture, you find that God is always doing it this way. Look at the life of Abraham and Sarah. You'll see it playing out. You see it playing out in the life of Paul. This is what he's describing in Romans chapter 7. And so there's somebody driven by the Holy Spirit who is convicting them, asking them questions, and that's our job. And so if we're not close enough to people to ask these questions, they never come to this fork in the road. And that's what happens to Paul in Romans 7. He's trying and failing and trying and failing, but eventually he comes to a fork in the road. So let's just explore a couple of quick insights about this moment of discovery. Okay? The first thing is this, that failure exposes the evidence. So rather than looking at a person and saying, oh, you failed, shame on you. I'm not saying it's okay to fail, but you understand that failure is how God unearths the evidence. I was just at an assembly in Michigan a couple weekends ago, and I was doing this. I was teaching it. I had seven sessions with them, and we had a chance to just kind of go into each one of these things and unpack it and go through some examples and everything. And I remember a number of people independently at different times throughout the weekend came up and said, thank you so much for sharing this, because in this place, we are not allowed to be who we really are. We are not allowed to admit to problems. I can't ask somebody for help, because the moment that I indicate that I've got a problem, I get judged and rejected. That's not grace. That's not what Christianity is all about. And so they're struggling with this. Failure is not something that you condemn. Failure is where you say, okay, you failed. What did that show? It's the evidence. And that's what you're helping them see. So there's redemption. Growth happens at the point of resistance. And so repeated failure, that's the pattern, leads a person to discovery. Well, what do we do with repeated failure? We get ticked off at the person and we say, you're not trying. Why do you keep doing that? Well, in fact, they are trying. That's why they keep failing. And that's what Paul did in Romans 7. But God doesn't give up on him. He keeps pressing on with him. And it was that that brings him to the point of discovery. Okay? You never want the person to stop trying, even if it means that they're going to fail, because the failure leads them where they need to go. So, for example, what do they need to discover? They need to discover, I'm not as good as I thought I was, and I'm not as strong as I thought I was. But when they come to this fork in the road, and this is where Paul comes to at the end of chapter 7, it leads to a choice. It leads to a choice. I'm either going to resist what the evidence shows about me, or I'm going to submit to what that evidence says about me. And this is what Paul does. This is how he comes to the place of salvation, his salvation experience described in Acts. But we don't know exactly what scene Paul has in mind at the end of chapter 7. But he comes to this point in time where he says, after all this failure, what a wretched man I am. Who will deliver me from this body of death? This body that keeps following Master Sin's orders. I can't get him to follow the law of my mind. It keeps following the law of sin. I can't get him to stop. Okay? And so he's at this fork in the road. And so if he makes the right choice, then everything changes. Right? And so, for example, oops. If he chooses here, I'm not. If he chooses the right choice, he's going to experience gradual supernatural transformation. We'll get to that in just a minute. But you understand that when you're working with a person, my job is not to make that. I can't make the choice for them, right? Only they can make that choice. But my job is to stand at that fork in the road. And if I have a choice between resisting the evidence or accepting the evidence and submitting to it, my job in helping them is to say, go this way, submit to it, because this is where this is the path to freedom. And so that's all that I can do. I can pray for them at that point. I can point them in the right direction. I can encourage them. I can be there and be their friend, but I can't make them make the choice. And so that's what is involved in these. Like I said, if they make the right choice, then the result is gradual change, gradual transformation. And so, in a sense, our choice is what determines what happens next. If they resist, then the grip of sin is strengthened in their life, and we become less like Jesus. But if we submit to what this evidence is showing about me, and I confess my need, and I trust God's provision in Christ, then the grip of sin is weakened, and I become more like Jesus. And over time, as we continue to submit, making that hard choice, what happens? Step by step, Jesus, the character of Jesus, the life of Jesus, is revealed more and more. It's like this curtain gets pulled back a little bit more with each choice that I have, okay? Each time that I submit. Now, this is not easy. This is not easy. And so in this next clip, you're going to see an example of the now converted Caleb, the husband. He's now a believer. And so he has some issues besides the way that he, his attitude towards his wife. He also has an internet porn addiction. And so she knows this. And so this is causing one of the reasons why their marriage is in difficulty. And so now he is a believer. And he has to decide what he's going to do with this. Okay? So just watch how he's choosing and what it does. Don't worry, you're not going to see anything, okay? So just thought I'd let you know that. He's at the fork.
Day 23, watch out for parasites. A parasite is anything that latches onto you or your partner and sucks the life out of your marriage. They're usually in the form of addictions like gambling, drugs, or pornography. They promise pleasure, but grow like a disease and consume more and more of your thoughts, time, and money. They steal away your loyalty and heart from those you love. Marriage is rarely survived when parasites are present. If you love your wife, you must destroy any addiction that has your heart. If you don't, it will destroy you.
Mr. Rudolph? Caleb? You doing okay today?
No, not really.
Talking to that guy. He is weird. Take one to know one.
Okay. So, once again, you can see the struggle. And this is what shocks so many new Christians to find out that after they have claimed Christ as their Savior, they expect all their problems to go away. And it doesn't. It's a struggle. Choices have to be made. The Christian life advances on your choices, not on what you know. It's not on your knowledge. You do have to know. You do have to learn. But the purpose of that knowledge is to help you make more informed choices. But progress is made at the point of resistance, because it's at the point of resistance where I have to make my choices. So it's all about choices that people have to make. And so whether it's in my own life or I'm helping somebody else, I'm helping them make those choices. And so it's that when I make the right choice, then it's the power of the Spirit of God that's helping me do that, but it's also that power of the Spirit that's revealing more of Christ to me, just a little bit. Does that mean that because he got rid of his computer that now he's never going to be tempted again? No. He'll find other ways to be tempted. He's got his phone, he's got his pad, he's got his office computer, he's got all kinds of other places where he still is going to have to face these choices. But he's making a decision, and that's the important part of it. Okay? So, you look at the Apostle Paul. When he came to this fork in the road on the day of his conversion, and I think you come to these forks in multiple places throughout your experience as a believer. And so he was transformed from a Christ-hating, Christian-killing zealot into a Christ-loving, evangelizing messenger of the faith. And so, and look at what's said of him. This man who formerly persecuted us is now preaching the faith that he once tried to destroy. That's the change. Did it happen overnight? It did not happen overnight. One step at a time. And so you look at the people who fed into Paul's life. We don't know of too many. We know of him feeding into other people's lives, but not so much people who were feeding into his life. But you remember, the first person that we hear of who actually ministered to him that we know of was Stephen. How did he do that? What was the scene? What's that?
He was a martyr.
Yeah, it was at Stephen's execution that Paul was presiding over. It's not like Stephen was talking to Paul, but that was a trigger moment. And so we don't know what was going on inside of Paul's head, but something was going on inside his head. So on the day that Christ encountered him on the road to Damascus, he was ready to convert. On the outside, it didn't look like it. He was breathing out threatenings, it said, but he was ready to convert. Nobody would have known it. And so after that, the next person that we read about, oh, what's his name again? Is it Barnabas? No. Is it Barnabas? Whatever. The guy in Damascus who's scared to death to go to Paul. Why? Because the last time they saw him, he was capturing Christians and killing them. And so God has to say, no, you need to go and help him because he's now converted. Oh, that's us. That's us. That's us having to take the risk of getting involved in someone's life with all the risk that goes with that, all the mess that's associated with that. And we say, oh, I don't know about this, Lord. This isn't going to work too well. I'm not sure if the gospel can handle this. And you say, no. The gospel has power, divine power. And when you put it all together, what do you end up with? You end up with the promise that the outcome is guaranteed. What does it say? That Paul says, I'm confident of this, that he who began a good work in you is going to carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Why did he have that kind of confidence? Because he had seen that in his own life. He wasn't at the end of the road, but he had made a lot of progress from what he used to be. And he was amazed at himself. In a very humble way, he was amazed at what God had done in his life through this process. Now, with the few minutes that we have left, if you can put together all the scenes that you have seen up until now, all especially all the battle scenes, okay, between this couple, and I think those of you a couple weeks ago when I was here and I was walking you through another diagram, which, believe it or not, is actually linked to this, I opened up with a clip of them arguing, remember? Intense knockdown, drag out battle between a husband and a wife. And they get to the point where he's just in her face and she's crying and she wants out, and he says, that's great, okay? You want to be done with this marriage? That's fine with me, okay? And that's what's carrying all the way through. That's what's motivating her to start searching for love in other places. And this is what's causing him to justify himself, even though he's starting to make efforts to redeem the relationship, okay? Now, you take that kind of a scene, and you compare that with this scene. And in between that first scene, which you're imagining, and this scene, which you're about to see, is this process. this process described in Scripture through the gospel. Not just the message of the gospel, but the method that it describes. This is what makes the difference to make this next scene possible.
Yeah, here. I've learned you never leave your partner, especially in the fire.
So what's happening?
Dad asked me if there was anything in me that wanted to save our marriage. And it gave me something.
So what day are you on?
43.
Who's only 40?
Who says that to someone? But halfway through, I realized that I did not understand what love was. And once I understood that, I wanted to do it.
Kevin, I want to believe that this is real. But I'm not ready to say that I trust you again.
I understand that. Whether you ever reach that point or not, I need you to understand something.
I'm sorry. I have been so selfish. For the past 7 years, I have trampled on you with my words and with my actions. I have loved other things when I should have loved you. In the last few weeks, God's given me a love for you that I never had before. And I've asked him to forgive me. And I'm hoping and praying that somehow you can be able to forgive me too. You can have all the time you need.
So we come to the end, and what a conclusion. The story goes on from here, obviously, but this is the turning point. And this is the moment that we work for in ministry. This is the moment that we look for in our own lives. And what's the key? The key is that at least one person has been humbled. Isn't that what the point of the process is? To humble us. And so that's what he learns. And so unlike that one of the earlier clips that we saw where he was, you know, giving half-hearted efforts, and you could see that he wasn't really into it. Now he's totally involved in it. Why? Because, not because he's learned a technique, but because his heart has been broken before God. He has seen his need. Now he knows how to express the love of Jesus. Not his imitation of that love, but he's allowing Jesus to love through him. And that's the difference. Okay? And so, why do we show this? Because at camp, this is what we're supposed to be doing. We only have 5 days with kids, really. But this is what we're trying to do. We're trying to move them a little further down the road. And so what are we looking for? We're looking for those triggers. We're looking for those responses. We're being with them, watching them, befriending them so that we can see these things. We're asking them questions. We're reminding them of the three facts at the top. That's our job. At the end of the day, this is all that there is to the Christian life. We muddy it up by this thing we call church. We throw so many activities and so many different things. Do this, do this, do this. And by the time people are done, they're exhausted. But the fact is that the gospel, when it's at the core of everything that we do, it simplifies everything and it clarifies everything. This is what we're supposed to be doing. And so this is how we organize church. This is how we organize camp. This is how we organize our families around a core, around a gospel that understands that it's not just a message, but it is a process. And this is how it works. And so we want to create an environment where we can walk with people through this process in meaningful relationships. So if you have any questions about it, I have here, while we take a quick break and we get ready for the next thing, This is a little card that you can put up on your refrigerator, because you know that it is not official until it's on your refrigerator, right? And so you just kind of pass these out. And on the back side of it, on the front side of it, is the diagram itself. Jackson, if you could just kind of take the rest of them. On the back side is actually just a quick summary of all the points that we have just mentioned.